The object of this program is not to put the frighteners on you, but it is to get the whole business of mushroom poisoning into some kind of perspective. Because there is, in fact, more fallacy and more humbug about poisonous toadstools than there is real danger. That isn't to say that the danger doesn't exist, but it's no more, say, than picking berries out of a hedgerow.
For children of the 60s, the so-called magic mushroom achieved legendary status as a free, and if eaten fresh, legal way to get high. Although not as famous or infamous nowadays, this tiny mushroom still flourishes each year in places as far apart as central London parklands and the valleys of South Wales.
Psilocybe semilanciata is a very common mushroom which is found widely all over England and in many other countries, usually in grassy surroundings. Well, I personally wouldn't recommend experimenting with these things because they can cause serious problems at times, and also because of the problem of flashbacks. You might be driving or doing something quite important or quite risky, and it's not nice to have your hallucinogenic experience coming back out of the blue up to 4 months after you have taken your mushrooms. And that is one reason why these mushrooms should be viewed with a lot of caution.
You shouldn't really take hallucinogenic mushrooms if you're feeling depressed, run down, or in a stressful environment, because if you do, you can find that it's not a pleasant experience, because hallucinogenic mushrooms and other hallucinogens tend to simply amplify the mood you're in already. So if you're depressed and stressed, then that's going to be made worse by the mushrooms or any other hallucinogen.
This mushroom has to be taken in considerable quantities. One needs to take about 30 or so mushrooms to get a hallucinogenic experience. And then it is usually a distortion of reality rather than some sort of dreamlike different state. It's very interesting with hallucinogenic mushrooms because it depends very much on what the user expects. If somebody thinks they're going to be poisoned, well, then they usually have vomiting, they feel sick, they may lose consciousness. Whereas if a person is taking a hallucinogenic mushroom for a hallucinogenic experience, well, then they will get the experience that they're looking for.
This is everybody's idea of a poisonous toadstool. It really looks as though it's not one to eat. And in this case, looks are not deceptive. It's got this red cap, it's got these scabby patches on top of it. It contains very powerful hallucinogens. It also contains other complicated poisons which produce very nasty side effects. But it has been used to produce trances in Siberian tribes and Laplanders. Very sexist, some of them, by the way. They used to have their women chew it up first and spit out all the nasty poisons, and then the male shamans continued chewing and went into their trance.
The powerful hallucinogens produced by these mushrooms go part way to explaining why man has attributed them with mystical, supernatural power. The mystique pervades our cultural history. Mushrooms are depicted in illustrations wherever a feeling of magic and mystery is required, and there's no doubt it works. But there's another very good reason why man has lived in awe and fear of some fungal species. The red plague of the Bible was a kind of rust fungus that attacks wheat and can wipe out our most basic foodstuff. Later on in the 11th century, a dreadful disease began to afflict the peasant populations of Europe. The symptoms were sometimes violent convulsions and madness, sometimes gangrene and loss of limbs. It was accompanied by a terrible burning sensation. And for seven long centuries, the peasantry were haunted by a fear of a tortuous, lingering death. They turned to religion to relieve the scourge, and by the 12th century, all hopes were pinned on St. Anthony. He allegedly had power over fire and flames, and the disease was called St. Anthony's fire. It was discovered much later to be due to a tiny fungus known as ergot.
And this is what all the fuss is about. Where, you are asking? Well, have a closer look at this particular grass head here. In it are growing these little black things, which are in fact the ergots. Now that's still pretty common in ryegrass, although thankfully not in our daily bread, because of course cereal crops are screened. But you can imagine how easy it would have been to have caught that up with the harvest without knowing that you'd even got it, particularly if you didn't even know what you were looking for. And then 2 or 3 weeks or months later, arms and legs start dropping off. Now this thing is actually called a sclerotium. It's black on the outside, and if I break it open, you can see that it's white inside. Now that falls to the ground and it overwinters, and then another little microscopic stage produces spores which blow about in the wind and they reinfect next year's grasses.
Incidents of fungal poisoning are frequently dealt with here at a specialised poisons unit of Guy's Hospital in London. It's a national coordinating centre.
The commonest groups of mushroom which cause problems are the ones which cause irritation of the stomach. So they will cause vomiting quite soon after they've been eaten. And usually that's all there is to it. The other mushrooms that can cause serious problems are the Jaramitra group, which contain a very complicated chemical called monomethyl hydrazine, which has also been used as rocket fuel. Now, these mushrooms can cause symptoms coming on about 12 hours after ingestion. And so late onset of symptoms is always something to be quite concerned about.
One of the most frequent, and ironically the prettiest of fungi producing those gastric symptoms is Russula emetica. It grows under conifers and it's actually called the sickener, but you're unlikely to confuse it with something edible. Unlike poison pie, Hebbaloma crustuliniforme, which has been picked and eaten in mistake for a common mushroom, its mature gills are salmony, like a young field mushroom, and it grows in grassy places. Some of the smaller parasol mushrooms, like Lepiota cristata, can produce sickness and stomach pain, although most dangerous lepiotas aren't big enough to be attractive for eating. Problems can arise when an edible species grows with a poisonous one. Marasmius aureades, the edible fairy ring mushroom, appears in grass, but it can grow with a similar-looking Clytocybe dealbeata. Now, it's a softer texture and paler, and it lacks the characteristic little root of Marasmius, but it's the kind of pitfall you have to look out for. One particular species, the shaggy ink cap, is very good to eat, but it mustn't be confused with the common ink cap. This often grows through tarmac drives, and it's harmless unless you happen to have alcohol on the dinner table. If you consume both together, uncomfortable things happen. You feel unpleasantly drunk.
Toadstool hunting is not for the faint-hearted. Now, look at that. You'd go past that and you think, what on earth is it if you've never seen it before? It looks like a piece of white celery, doesn't it? That is a thing called Helvella, and there are several species of it. It's actually very closely related to the morels, but it contains a substance called helvellic acid, and it's poisonous. Not deadly poisonous, but enough to give you a nasty stomach upset. So any of those need avoiding.
The Helvellas are all less than common. They appear in autumn, growing on woodland floors, and they've got such bizarre shapes as to be instantly recognisable for what they are. Some fungi, like common earthball, contain stomach irritants, but nevertheless they've been used on the continent in small quantities as flavourings. This one's been popular in Czechoslovakia as a peppery condiment, but it's not worth experimenting. You might finish up with nasty after effects. Several species of Inosybe are dangerous. Most, but not all of them, have dull-coloured conical caps and pallid gills. And many, like Inosybe bongardii, have interesting smells. This one's got an aroma of ripe pears.
The other group is the Amanita. There are various species of Amanita, the so-called death cap, Amanita phalloides, and one or two other types of Amanita, which can cause very serious poisoning, and those ones cause symptoms coming on about, well, between 8 or 10 or 12 hours after the mushroom has been eaten. They cause vomiting and diarrhea, and that settles down, and then later on the patient can get liver failure coming on after 2 or 3 days. So that's perhaps the most worrying type of mushroom of all.
Although most of the Amanitas fall into this dangerous category, several of them are also edible and good. But it's best to avoid them all, even the blusher, Amanita rubescens. Now, it's eaten on the continent, and it's fine when cooked because its poisons are destroyed by heat. But if you eat it raw, it's extremely dangerous. Another source of confusion is this, the false death cap, Amanita citrina. In itself, it's harmless, and like the blusher, it's got all the familiar characteristics of the Amanitas. There are large white patches on the cap, the usual white gills and stalk, there's an obvious ring and a large bulbous base. But it has been misrepresented, even in textbooks, as the death cap. Now, as newspaper headlines testify, certain mushrooms can and do kill. Doctors are still learning about the more dangerous mushrooms. The Lecoq family were saved from almost certain death by having their blood cleansed, passing it through a charcoal filter. Not surprising that mushroom poisonings proved a favourite with crime novelists. Of all the species of large fungi in the British Isles, only 2 or 3 are highly dangerous with no known effective treatment. The death cap itself, Amanita phalloides, grows with oaks, but it can be found throughout mixed woodland. It doesn't look like a typical Amanita. It's got no patches on the cap, and that varies in color from greenish olive to pale tan. Death cap doesn't smell or taste unpleasant. It does have an obvious ring and a large basal bulb with a volval bag.
A poisoning by death cap is certainly nothing new. Here in Italy, they've known about it for an awful long time. Nero's mother was an ambitious lady called Agrippina. And she married the Emperor Claudius, but she decided, so that Nero could become emperor, that she would see Claudius off. And she employed a strange lady called Locusta to prepare a dish of his favourite fungus, a thing called Amanita caesarea, which is still very popular around here, into which she introduced the juice of the death cap. The rest, as they say, is history. And this is the death cap's sister. It's pure white, so you can imagine how easy it would be for somebody at a glance to pick that up and think it was an edible mushroom. And yet, it's lethal. It's got an apt title, the destroying angel. And the two of them probably make up the most dangerous plants known to man. See, one of the problems with this is that it doesn't have, it's actually quite deeply rooted, so we can get it out. It doesn't have the scales on it that would tell you it was an Amanita. It's got a ring on the stem, and it's got a bulbous base with a great big bag on it. Now, that's what it looks like when it's fully matured, but over here, there is a young one, which always typically has a conical cap on it. Now, a bit of this, the size of half my little fingernail, would see me off.
One cardinal mistake is to imagine that if a fungus has been nibbled by animals, it's harmless. Some creatures, like slugs and maggots, have a built-in immunity to toxins that would kill humans. So what do you do if you've eaten a doubtful mushroom?
The first thing is to try and get another specimen, like the one that you've just eaten, because then you can take it to an expert and get it identified. If you're not sure what it looked like, well, you shouldn't have eaten it in the first place, but one then has to seek medical advice. If you start to have symptoms, well, then you may have taken something poisonous. It might have been something else in the meal, but it could have been the mushroom. As far as symptoms are concerned, symptoms that come on within 6 hours are likely to be short-lived and don't represent serious poisoning. It's symptoms that come on after 6 hours that represent serious poisoning.
Most animals have an instinct to tell them what's good and what's bad. We can only effectively stay on the safe side by learning to distinguish one from the other.
No, you have to find out which it is. There are no rules whatsoever. There are all sorts of myths about silver spoons and, you know, go black when you cook mushrooms, poisonous mushrooms. But there are no direct rules, but there are certain things that you can do to sort of safeguard yourself, I suppose. The genus Amanita, which have these sort of vulva cups that they grow out of, so the mushroom is growing out of this sort of cup thing, and I'm sure you've seen plenty of those. In the genus Amanita are some of the most poisonous. The death cap is an Amanita and so on. And so it would be much better to avoid them altogether, although there are a couple that are edible.
I think you have to be quite clear in your own mind about each individual mushroom. It's not a question of saying this looks nice, or it smells nice, or it's a nice color. One has to be sure of the species of each mushroom. So you want to go with somebody experienced. Short of that, you want to go with a book which has got plenty of detail in it, and you want to be 100% convinced that that mushroom represents the one in the book which is safe to eat.
In the herbarium at Kew Gardens in London, More than 30,000 larger fungi, mushrooms and toadstools from all over the world are stored. The fruiting bodies are dried, labelled and catalogued, and they can then be used as a source of reference in the future. Sometimes external appearances are enough for identification. That's important if a poisonous specimen is suspected. But in many instances, the only way to separate one species from another is by looking at fine differences of spores and hyphae under the microscope. Fungi can be destructive in a number of ways, not always by injuring our health. They can cause great economic damage, particularly to buildings.
I think the important thing to remember is that whereas there are lots of fungi that can either nourish us or poison us, there are two sorts of fungi that can actually eat our homes and our houses. The best known and the most voracious of these is the dry rot fungus, Serpula lacrimans, and there are several varieties of fungus that produce what is known as wet rot. Dry rot has the ability to spread throughout a building from cellar to attic. You know, dry rot is the one that jolly nearly sank the British Navy. Something like three out of four ships at one time had dry rot, and a lot of the hearts of oak, in fact, had very rotten bottoms. In 1810, I think the Queen Charlotte was launched, a 110-gun ship. And it actually had to be rebuilt before it was commissioned because the dry rot was spreading so fast and so rapidly. Now, that doesn't happen quite so quickly in a building, but nevertheless, dry rot can spread at something over a metre a year, given the right conditions for growth. Well, of course, if you're unlucky, the first time you notice it is when you fall through the floor. It is important, of course, to get rid of every trace of it because it can spread rather like a cancer. And you've got to be very sure that you do a very thorough exposure of all the plaster work and getting right down to the masonry on which the timber is fixed to or to which it's joining on, because dry rot can spread through its strands and its mycelium over the surface of brickwork, over masonry, through tiny little joints in stonework and so forth. And so you've got to be jolly sure that you get all the outbreaks thoroughly exposed before you can cut it out, burn it, and then replace it with treated timber. And of course, treat the surrounding area with a strong fungicide.
So, there are some villains in the world of fungi. There are species that damage our health, and there are species that demolish our homes. There's one species that almost once wrecked the British Navy. But you have to keep it in perspective. The vast majority of fungi are completely harmless. There are many that are of great benefit. Only very, very few are real baddies.
Oh.
The object of this programme is not to put the frighteners on you, but it is to get the whole business of mushroom poisoning into some kind of perspective. Because there is, in fact, more fallacy and more humbug about poisonous toadstools than there is...
For children of the 60s, the so-called magic mushroom achieved legendary status as a free, and if eaten fresh, legal way to get high. Although not as famous or infamous nowadays, this tiny mushroom still flourishes each year in places as far apart as central London parklands and the valleys of South Wales.
Psilocybe semilanciata is a very common mushroom which is found widely all over England and in many other countries, usually in grass.
Real danger. That isn't to say that the danger doesn't exist, but it's no more, say, than picking berries out of a hedgerow.
Surroundings. Well, I personally wouldn't recommend experimenting with these things because they can cause serious problems at times, and also because of the problem of flashbacks. You might be driving or doing something quite important or quite risky, and it's not nice to have your hallucinogenic experience coming back out of the blue up to 4 months after you have taken your mushrooms. And that is one reason why these mushrooms should be viewed with a lot of caution.
You shouldn't really take hallucinogenic mushrooms if you're feeling depressed, run down, or in a stressful environment, because if you talk, go ask.